It is yet another great day in Garner.
Okay, I'm Garner Mayor Ronnie Williams, and we're here today with another installment of our segment that we call Great People in Garner. With us today, and we're very honored to have Dr. Stephen Scott from Wake Tech. Welcome to the program, Dr. Scott.
Thank you, Mayor. Glad to be here.
Let's just get right into the question. Tell us a little bit about your career. My notes say you've been in education for 35 years.
Actually, it's 40.
Well, my notes were wrong.
No, that's all right. I started as a part-time instructor in 1972 at Tri-County Technical College in Pendleton, South Carolina.
Interesting.
So I worked there as a part-timer for 4 years and taught public school during the day. So the reality is 36 years ago I started as a full-time employee in community colleges.
That's a very honorable career. In 2003, you were named the president of Wake Tech. Is that the right year?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
What has been your focus since taking over, since you took the reins here at Wake Tech?
Well, the main focus has been to prepare for growth, manage growth. You know, Mayor, one of the things that excited me about coming to Wake Tech was the building of the North Campus. Wake Tech had owned the land for about 9 or 10 years before I got here, and had not done anything with it. And we had a groundbreaking there in 2004. And now that campus is larger than 30 of the 58 standalone community colleges.
That sort of segues into the next question. What are the differences between Wake Tech and the rest of the community colleges?
Well, right now, one thing, of course, is just sheer size. An average community college has between 4,000 and 5,000 full-time equivalent students, and Wake Tech has about 18,000 full-time equivalent students. So we're as big as 4 average-size community colleges. A second thing is that Wake County is still in a growth mode.
Very much.
And we will be for the foreseeable future, and that's not true for a large number of the 58 community colleges, and especially those in rural areas, because I worked in Columbus County for 11 years, I worked in Lenoir County for 2 years, and those areas have not continued to grow like the Triangle area has.
What makes Wake Tech a comprehensive community college?
Well, that's a fairly long story.
We got time.
Okay. first of all, in most of the United States, community colleges are junior colleges.
Right.
That they offer first 2 years of university. So that's one piece, the junior college piece. A second piece is the technical programs. In some states, there are technical colleges that don't offer university transfer, and they're designed to put people to work in 2 years or less. So you got the transfer or the junior college portion, you have the technical portion, then you have in North Carolina the adult high school and the GED program. Most colleges offer a GED, and the GED was designed for the vets coming home after World War II rather than them going back to high school after they'd been to war, that this was created for the military. Well, in most states, the adult high school is offered by the public schools at night. Here in North Carolina, the community colleges offer the adult high school as well as the GED.
Mm-hmm.
And lastly, there is the economic development portion. meaning if a new company is coming to Garner, coming to North Carolina, that the community college will train the workforce for them for free as part of the incentive package to get them here. So you have the university transfer piece, you have the technical education piece, you have the adult high school and GED piece, and you have the economic and the workforce development. When you put all four of those pieces together, then you have a comprehensive community college. And North Carolina's system is the most comprehensive of all the 50 states.
Mm-hmm. As we walked in, there were students everywhere on this campus. What is your current enrollment?
Well, last year we served over 66,000 people during 11-12. We will probably get close to 70,000 people this year. Now, the majority of my students are part-time. They're not full-time students. That's still a difference about community colleges in North Carolina and particular Wake Tech, that we have two pieces. We have 40,000 students in continuing education, mm-hmm. and all of them by definition are part-time students. They're the police, fire, and emergency medical. They're the adult high school and GED. They're the person at home who's taking an online computer course. All of those fit into 40,000. Then we had 26,000 in academic programs. And the academic programs are what you normally think of at a college or a university. Of our 26,000 in academic programs, about 8,000 to 9,000 of them are full-time, but that means the remaining 17,000 are part-time students. So it is a very large enrollment, but on any given day, we'll have about 25,000 or 30,000 people that come to Wake mm-hmm. Tech and take a class.
Okay, the voters just recently approved a bond issue for Wake Tech.
Yes, sir.
Tell us about your plans with that, Dow.
Wow. Now, this is only a half-hour show.
I know. We'll edit.
We'll edit. Okay.
You've got a lot of plans, big plans.
Yes, we do. Yes, we do. What will the bonds do? The bonds will allow Wake Tech to put people back to work. As many as 20,000 students. It'll give us the capacity to serve them, and that would be the equivalent of about 5,000 full-time students. Here's what we're going to do. By the numbers sort of a thing, we're going to add about 500,000 square feet of additional classroom.
Bricks and mortar.
Yes, sir. Classroom space. We're going to add about 5,000 new parking spaces. We're going to redo about 3,000 existing parking spaces. We're going to build about a mile and a half of additional road. We're going to renovate. Right now, you and I are filming in the library. This library is about 40 years
back
old.
Back to the WW Holding days.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. This is the original campus, and we'll be celebrating the 50th anniversary of this campus in 2013, and I think you got a question about that, and we'll talk about it in a moment. But back building-wise, program-wise, the majority of the facilities will go to our north campus. We're going to build about 300,000 square feet on that site. There'll be three very large buildings, almost 100,000 square feet each. There will be one that will be an additional for healthcare. We have a medical campus, as you know, there on Sunnybrook Road, adjacent to Wake Med, mm-hmm. but now that campus is full. We have built out all the land that Wake Tech has at that site, and whenever you look at the jobs for the future, one of the first ones that always pops up is medical careers. So one of the buildings on the North Campus will be for healthcare. A second of the building will be for technology, computer science, gaming, simulations. A third building will be general education, English, math, science. One of the justifications for the bond was the fact that we had had 5,000 people on a waiting list at the beginning of the last five semesters. Now think about that, Mayor. Mm-hmm. Being a businessman, we had customers who had applied to the college, been accepted, and tried to register for courses. And there were no courses available or no seats available in the courses for the past five semesters. So that was part of our justification back to the county commissioners, that we had that many people and it was continuing for five semesters. So we needed the additional space. So that's part of it, the North Campus. Then on Chapinock Road at our public safety campus, we will be renovating 35,000 square feet on that campus for police, fire, emergency medical training on that site. Then on the campus that we're on here, which was the original college campus, mostly it'll be for renovations. Got a lot of 30, 40, 50 year old air conditioners.
And it's just to bring you up current, right?
That's right. That's correct. It will not add any additional square feet on this campus. Mm-hmm. It'll just be renovations and repairs. The other piece will be the RTP campus, and maybe we can get a shot when we go back or when we finish to show the model. The model of the RTP campus there near the airport and 540. As a matter of fact, it is the last free exit on 540 South. If you don't get off at Highway 54, then you're going to have to pay a toll going down. So the bond will be used to basically help 20,000 people find jobs, get the skills that they need in order to find jobs.
In addition to the needs that will be addressed, what infatuated or interested the voters is there was no tax increase.
Right.
That was a good seller, and the county commissioners as well.
Yes, sir.
You're branding an initiative called Future Forward College. Can you tell us about that?
Yes, I can. When the recession came back in 2008, a lot of people said they didn't see it coming. I mean, you know, the economy was going great. And then all of a sudden, things started imploding. Going downhill, yes. And so that reinforced to me that if you're not looking at the future, you're certainly going to be blindsided by it. And even if you're looking for the future, doesn't necessarily mean that you'll be able to predict what's going to happen. But we know for sure if you're not looking. So here's what we've been trying to do. Is identify possible futures. I want all of our faculty to include future thinking. Now, by that, I mean, what is the future of my industry? If I'm thinking about going into simulation and gaming, let's say that. That's one of our fastest-growing IT programs. Then what is the trend? Well, the trend lately has been mobile apps, mm-hmm. You write the apps mm-hmm. for the handheld devices mm-hmm. Rather than the full-blown games. So I think that's one particular area. If I'm in healthcare, there's going to be huge changes coming up in healthcare. How will those changes affect me as a consumer? And if I'm a nurse, if I'm a dental hygienist, if I'm a surge technician or what? How are those possible changes? Might not be able to predict it for sure, but at least we need to be looking. So that's, we've brought in future speakers. We just had Stan Litow, who's vice president of IBM, to speak here the last week in November. And here's what we did. We had 400 people in a live audience. He came and did a 7 a.m. breakfast with about 50 faculty and staff members to talk about IBM, what are they doing to plan for the future. And then when he spoke at 10 o'clock to the students, we live here, we also had about 400 people over the internet who were watching his program, watching his presentation, and listening to what he was doing. That's one of the features of education.
We're going to do more of that.
We're going to do more of it, yes.
Okay, it may be pecking order, but the total educational system, where do community colleges fit in?
Dollar spent, number of students enrolled, which one?
All of the above.
All of the above, okay.
Let's say we got 30 minutes.
All right. Here in North Carolina, the public schools enroll, I think, about 1.5 million or 2 million students, and get about a little over $9 billion in state resources. The university system enrolls about 280,000 full-time equivalent students, and gets about $3 billion. The North Carolina Community College System enrolls more people, 800,000 people. The FTE is about the same as the university, with about 250 or 260,000, and gets $1 billion to operate from the state. It's about a ratio of 3. The community college is $1 billion, universities $3 billion, public schools about $9 billion. The ratio is pretty close there. Then here in Wake County, public schools enroll about 150,000 students, and Wake Tech, we enroll about 66,000. Mm-hmm. Our county budget is about $16 million, and the public schools county budget is $320 million. Mm-hmm. They get about 20 times as much county dollars as Wake Tech does.
With the downturn in the economy,
yes,
did it result in, well, a lot of people lost their jobs. Did
yes.
it result in enrollment increase and people were trying to retrain?
Yes, it did. Wake Tech was growing at the rate of about 7 or 8% from, say, 2003 and 2004 through 2008. Suddenly, when people started losing the jobs, we went from 8% to 10 or 12% growth. So we added about another 4% increase in enrollment. Mr. Mayor, we went through a 4-year period where our budget was cut about 21% per student, okay, on a per student basis. Yet at the same time, our enrollment grew 31%. We have been growing faster than the budget cuts. That's good news in one side, but it's bad news. That's right. You know, it's selling at a loss and trying to make it up on volume. Mm-hmm. It doesn't always work.
Mm-hmm. Wake Tech's role in economic development, you briefly touched on that earlier, but you have a good relationship with the business community. And did you say some of that is free to training?
Yes. When an existing company creates net new jobs, then Wake Tech will come in and train their workforce for them for free. It has to be in manufacturing or warehousing or software. It can't be retail, I guess is the best way to say mm-hmm. it. And that's the same deal that the state of North Carolina would provide to the new company. We always hear about the benefits to the new company. Well, basically, those benefits apply to existing companies. When an existing company in Wake County is growing, then they can apply for those same kind of training benefits, training incentives, and Wake Tech will come in, customize the program to their needs, and then put the trainers on site for those companies.
Touch on a little bit the difference between economic development and the workforce.
Sure. Workforce development is for the individual. In other words, it is for you and I if we learn a new skill. If before we did not know how to use spreadsheets, we did not know how to use certain machine tools, we did not know how to program software, that when you and I learn how to do those, then suddenly we can do different things back at the firms. That's the skills mismatch that they're talking about, that people may have industrial skills that might require a strong back, whereas they need problem-solving skills, they need team-building skills, how do you work in teams and get things done. So the workforce development is, generally speaking, applies to the individual. Okay, and so you want to build a cohort of people that can work in biotechnology. You want to build a cohort of people that can work with software or hardware. So that's the core meaning of the term workforce development. Then economic development, on the other hand, means either helping your existing firms to grow and expand, or to attract the new firm. And the new firms tend to get all the ink or the airtime, yes, because they're new. And you know, we Americans like new. What is new and wonderful in America?
Yeah, everything's pretty when it's new.
Absolutely. You know, new car smell, the shine is still on it. But the reality is so much of our resources is directed toward the existing companies to try to help them grow and expand. There's another piece too, Mr. Mayor, that the local economic developers and the regional economic developers, Charles Hayes and his group, and then the North Carolina Department of Commerce. Here's one of the things that we have done differently as a future forward college at Wake Tech. That when I got here in 2003, one of the first things I asked was, what industries or clusters of industries is Wake County looking at, is the Triangle region looking at, and is the state of North Carolina looking at to try to attract companies of that kind? One was biotechnology. Biotechnology is hot, still is, still very big, well-paying jobs, good growth potential in that area.
Okay, the word average sometimes is overused, but would you describe your average student?
Yes. Got two kinds of average students, okay? They're different, okay? The 26,000 students in academics, okay? Those 26,000 are younger. Their average age is 28, and probably next year will be 27. Those students would be a mother of one child, about 28 years old, working during the day, going to school either at night or online. One of the big changes is that online classes have replaced a large portion of night classes. people who used to go at night are now taking online classes. Mm-hmm. Okay. Then the continuing ed student is 10 years older. It once again is white female with 1.7 children.
And they've been in the workforce a while.
They've been in the workforce a while and are now trying to get a better job. Our average, we had about 55% female, 45% male. The racial demographics, we reflect the county as the county demographics go. So that's kind of our typical student, but it depends if they're in curriculum, meaning they want a degree or diploma, or they're in continuing education, that they want to get those skills as soon as possible to use on their existing job or to get a better job.
Okay, talk a bit about the Ripple Effect Major Gifts campaign.
Sure, sure. Right in the middle of the recession, we were planning a major gifts campaign that, you know, the big universities have billion-dollar campaigns mm-hmm. with a B. Community colleges have million-dollar campaigns mm-hmm. with an M. Right at the beginning of the recession, we had planned to start a campaign for three purposes. One for student scholarships, the second for faculty and staff improvement, primarily faculty improvement, and the third was for technology, that we never have enough technology. Now, to put that in perspective, you know how much money Wake Tech gets to help our faculty and staff stay up to date? Zero. We get no faculty development funds. The second is technology. That's our middle name, you know, technical and community, technology and people. That's what we're all about. And that we get about $3 million a year for technology and need about 12 a year every year. In other words, people don't come to us to learn how to use old equipment or old software. They want to learn how to use the latest technology equipment.
And it changes weekly sometimes.
And it does. It's by the hour. It probably changed while you and I were talking here this morning. So that's a huge demand. So we thought, you know, when you throw a rock or a pebble into a still body of water, you get the ripple effect. It moves out circles, like that. So that was the name given to our campaign, and we are still actually in the quiet phase of that campaign. But during the recession, they surveyed about 50 or 75 business leaders in the community and asked, did Wake Tech, if we went forward, how successful would that campaign be? And the initial goal was set at 10. We've already exceeded 10 million. And the new goal has been set at $12 million dollars for the campaign. And so that's business, industries, and individuals making commitments to Wake Tech for student scholarships, for faculty improvement, faculty education, and for technology, whether it's hardware, software, or equipment. Because a significant portion of that $10 million so far is in-kind contributions to Wake Tech.
Look, I know you're a busy man. I thank you for taking this time to talk with us today.
Thank you.